Hi, once again, it's really great to welcome you to worship. Tea and coffee, 12 noon, if you're watching on Sunday, as I always say. Please join us and share in that. It's been really helpful to do that. And through the week, songsters have a chat on Zoom at 7:30, and we have a quiz on Fridays at 7 p.m. Let's see who wins this week. Dawn and I are hosting this week's quiz. We'll know by Sunday who's won. It's really important to know as well that private prayer is continuing. You can access the worship hall on a Tuesday afternoon between 2 and 4. There'll be somebody here to greet you and register you being here and just give you a little bit of helpful information before you come into prayer. I'm in the worship hall now, and it's quite bleak to look around with just 26 chairs. But that's as it is. When that changes, we will let you know. Some really helpful stuff in this week's newsletter. If you make sure that you get a copy and you read it, whether that's online or we've been able to deliver out to folk throughout this last few days. Newsletter updates in there for lots of people in terms of health challenges and prayer requests. They're quite extensive. One or two of our folk are quite anxious about their well-being just now. So just have a look through the newsletter and remember them in prayer, if you would. You'll read about Edna Ainsley, about Kath Hammond, Linda Booker, Margaret Branston, Gloria Lewis, Julia Farnell, John Winter, Barry Stewart. And you may have people yourself that you're aware of need our prayers right now. There's an update in the newsletter as well about Booth House, some of the happenings and goings on there. And Jan is really keen for us to be able to continue to support Booth House. So you can read about that in the newsletter if you would. Really useful and encouraging, challenging article that Rian has written that talks about hidden treasure and some of the change of mindset. You suddenly focus on the things that you realise are important at this time throughout this pandemic when we've had a chance to reflect on those things. So enjoy the newsletter, have a look through. Today is a world first. John and Enid West, Lieutenant Colonels no less, their first ever virtual broadcast. And boy, are we looking forward to it. So let's welcome John and Enid as they lead us in worship today.
Good morning to you all. What's it got, final last Saturday? By any chance? I was trying to keep some form of tradition. The poor old soloist had to stand on the top of the stand in Wembley and sing Abide With Me. She probably would need it on the top of a stand. How many heard her is debatable. Two lines have been a kind of motto throughout the years for me. Change and decay in all around I see. O thou who changest not, abide with me. Some time ago, Brian Edwards reminded me of an article. Gave me this article, which I was interviewed with Enid in 1999. And I said at the time that the future will bring a greater use of the internet, multimedia-led worship, and who knows, perhaps sermons will be recorded for all time on DVD. Dear Lord, I never thought I would live long enough to see that prophecy fulfilled. So instead of what was, let's sing our first song, which proclaims the greatness of our God.
Thank you.
So let's turn our thoughts heavenward now and share in a prayer. It's a prayer by Edward Barnyard. Heavenly Father, we thank you that the immensity of your love, we are part of a great family, far greater than we can possibly manage, imagine, and drawn from age to age and from every part of the earth. We thank you that many as we are, you assure us through Jesus Christ that you know each one and every one to you is precious. Let this awareness of being part of a great company and the assurance that your love is ever about us give us a renewed sense of purpose in our daily living, that we may joyfully undertake and whatever you put into our hands and serve you in all things, whether we serve, our service be great or small. So we turn now to the songsters, after which Enid will share with us the scriptures.
Children of Mary, whose grief was high in joy. The Bible readings will take us back to the Old Testament and to selected verses. Firstly, from Genesis chapter 37. Joseph, at that time the youngest and the favourite son of Jacob, had been sent to take food to the 10 older boys, who were seeking pasture for their flocks. In verse 17, Joseph has been told that they were last seen heading for Dothan, and we pick it up from there. So Joseph went after his brothers and found them near Dothan. When they saw him in the distance, and before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. "Here comes that dreamer," they said to each other. "Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a wild animal has devoured him. Then we'll see what becomes of the dreams." So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his coat, the ornate coat that he was wearing, and took him and threw him in the cistern. The cistern was empty, there was no water in it. As they sat down for their meal, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices and balm and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt. Judah said, "What will we gain if we kill Joseph and cover up his blood? Come, let us sell him to these Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, our own flesh and blood." And the others agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, the brothers took Joseph out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt. Now we move forward many years. Joseph has survived being a slave and a prisoner and has been the explainer of dreams. And then he is given the exalted responsibility of collecting the surplus food during the 7 years of plenty, and now is the saviour of many during the 7 years of famine. Jacob's family have come for the second time to ask for food, and this time Joseph can hold back his emotions no longer. We pick up the story again at chapter 45. When Joseph could no longer control himself before his attendants, he cried out, "Make everyone leave my presence." So when there was no one left with Joseph, when he made himself known to his family, he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still living?" They were not able to answer him because they were terrified. Then Joseph said, "Come close to me." And when they had done so, he said, "I am Joseph. You sold me into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save many lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now there has been famine in the land, and for the next 5 there will be no ploughing or reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve a remnant of the family, to save you by a great deliverance. So then it was not you who sent me here, but God." Now the story doesn't quite end there, because the author of the book of Exodus starts his chapter by listing the number of Jacob's family who went to Egypt in the famine. It's almost as if he realizes that by now there were 12 boys and he's only named 11 of them. So he adds this little explanation at the end of verse 2. He says, "The descendants of Jacob numbered 70 in all, because Joseph was already in Egypt." Let's sing together, "He giveth more grace as our burdens grow greater," and then the band is going to play for us.
Thank you.
Corps Sergeant Major, I hasten to add this wasn't Stephen, stood behind the pulpit giving out his announcements when he was handed a handwritten note. Have you ever done that? Just as the Sergeant Major gets on the platform, stick a bit of paper in his hand. Anyway, this had got to be read to the congregation. And the note said, Mark Anderson, having gone to sea, his wife desires the prayers of the congregation for his safety. The Sergeant Major picked up the slip of paper and read aloud, Mark Anderson, having just gone to see his wife, desires the prayers of the congregation for his safety. It's a thought, isn't it, that the message we handle each week has come from God Himself. And we must be always careful of the changes we make. Let's sing, company, now sing for us, as they do so beautifully, and something that we've missed over many weeks.
La 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 la
Ye fearful saints, fresh courage take. The clouds ye so much... Well, what are these clouds we so much dread? There are certain things that all these clouds have in common. They're all in the future. They haven't happened yet. They might never happen. An illness that you may never have to suffer from. An interview that you may never have to undergo. The clouds are always the things that might happen. Sometimes these clouds involve a phobia of some sort. At one corps, our young people's Sergeant Major always collected a ball of hay from the farmer, and this formed the centrepiece of the harvest festival. One year, it was missing. It seemed that the farmer was very happy to lend it to us again, but he felt that she ought to know that the mother grass snake had made her nest in it that year. Now, they thought that all the baby snakes had gone, but the Sergeant Major decided not to have the ball that year. The thought of a baby snake leaving it in the middle of the morning service was more than she could cope with. These clouds that you so much dread. Many of the clouds of one generation are solved by the next. Smallpox, once so feared, now only exists in the laboratory. TB, once nearly the death of my father, now considered an inconvenience, easily treated. Conversely, some of the things that our grandparents never heard of could be the clouds of the future. The internet, social media, genetic engineering, all such wonderful opportunities placed in evil hands. Who knows what clouds may yet form? Clouds ye so much dread, always in the future, usually concerning the unknown, usually personal. Let's go back to our Bible verses. Joseph was sold as a slave and later imprisoned on false evidence. One day he would be prime minister of all Egypt, but he didn't know that, not then. The other sons of Jacob had planned his death and lied to their father, and years later the guilt of what they had done weighed heavily upon him. But Joseph had not died, and he was not a slave. But they didn't know that, not then. Old Jacob was convinced that his son was dead. Nothing could change that. He wasn't. But Jacob didn't know that, not then. And then the famine starts. They've heard that there is corn for sale in Egypt. But is that just false news? Clouds ye so much. Eventually, everything turns out to be wonderful. Joseph is safe and successful. There is food, enough for the entire family. Jacob reunited with his beloved son. So what's the key to all this joy? The final Bible verse says it all. Joseph was in Egypt already. And as it was for the family of Joseph, so it is for us, that the one who loves us and cares what happens to us is there already. What does life hold for us? Who can say? Who can guess what major fears of today will be solved in the years to come? And who can guess what we now do in ignorance might be a huge concern for the generations to come? We have no answers to questions like this. But the Bible answer, that stands firm, that the one who loves us and has our interests at heart, the one who cares what happens to us, is in the future already. We do not walk forward into an empty space. We walk forward into his company. So let's just commit ourselves to the Lord before we sing our final song. Dear Lord, just as Joseph was able to see the hand of God upon his life, so may we entrust into your hands our world, the pandemic that still awaits its solution, our nation, our core, our families, and ourselves. Into your hands we commit ourselves this day. Amen. And now let's sing together, Lord, for the years.
Thank you.